Okay, looks like we've got signal. I'm just gonna do that. Here we go.
Sci-Fi for Me is about to take you on an incredible journey into the realms of science fiction, fantasy, and horror. Interviews with writers, filmmakers, artists, and actors. Conventions and fandom. Previews and reviews of movies and television. Sci-Fi for Me is working to be the most popular science fiction magazine in the solar system. Subscribe now and enter the fantastic world of Sci-Fi for Me, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
I have winky blinkies, ladies and gentlemen. I know the sound is working today. I remembered to turn it on. I hit the button. Welcome, everybody. We are live from the bunker. My name is Jason Hutt. I'm the editor here at scififorme.com, which is back up and running. We have at least fixed that part so you can see the website, although we still can't log in to do anything to update it yet. That's coming, though. We're, half a loaf at this point. Anyway, so there's that. Want to give a shout-out to everybody who is listening to this show as a podcast. We are live Monday through Open Line Friday at 1 p.m. Eastern. But if you prefer, we're on multiple podcast platforms, so you can check us out there. And we do invite you to join our Discord server. You can always leave a comment, whether you're here live or not. You can send us an email, livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. And we do have a newsletter. Eventually, I'll get a new one out. So, anyway. Busy week this week. And today is no different. We have a guest, and we did not uninvite this guest. Toni Weisskopf is here. She is the publisher and editor at Baen Books, which publishes one of my favorite lines of stories, the Honor Harrington verse from David Weber. She has been on the program before, and it's been way too long. Welcome back.
Well, thank you, Jason. It is great to be back. I know you've been busy, and I've been busy too.
It's one of those things. I frequently, when I have a guest that returns, I'll usually go back and I'll look and see when they were here. I was like, it's been that long? I mean, every single time I turn around, because it feels like it was just a few months ago, and it turns out to be a little bit longer than that. So we have to make sure that we don't do this, as spread out. We got to do this more frequently. I don't want to do too much. The awards thing, the uninviting thing. I mean, there are people out there that are still trying to make this a thing. But I want to ask you, as the publisher of Baen Books, when the controversy of this stuff happens, whether it's Worldcon or Dragon Awards or Nebulas or Saturns, whoever, somebody starts making noise about something. As the publisher, does that affect any business-related decisions on any of this stuff? Because, used to be, if a book won an award, that was a marketing coup. That was something that you could promote and you could hype. You could say, hey, winner of the fill-in-the-blank award. Are they relevant anymore, even for that?
I don't think so, no. At Baen, years ago, I tried to continue the line of the publishing the Hugo-winning stories. That was back in the late 80s, early 90s. We got some big name authors to write the introductions. But even back then, it really wasn't hitting the heart of the market as I think it did more reliably in the 50s, 60s, 70s, which is a shame. I don't think it really affects bottom line. I don't think awards are terribly important for marketing anymore. It's nice for the authors, sure. And it can be hurtful for the authors when they are excluded. It's frustrating. I'll admit. I do like the way that the Dragon Awards do things. They leave nominations are open to anybody. You don't have to be a member of their convention to vote or to nominate titles. And they encourage people with large fandoms to let their fandoms know about it. So that it truly is a reflection of popular taste. Which is not for everybody. That's why there's lots of awards, and that's that's a good thing.
Well, and we were talking ahead of the show about how Baen kind of takes that line of we're publishing the books. We're not advocating, we're not policing, we're not censoring, we're not going to sit there and say you can do this, you can do that, and you're not allowed to do this, which I think is a smart way to do it. Because, like you said, the fans have to be the ones who make those choices, and it's not a smart thing for certain companies to sit there and go, how dare you, and shake your finger at fans when the fans say, well, we don't like what you did. So is it ever a challenge to bite your tongue?
No, never. My authors are awesome, and never, ever. I mean, it's the question is how do you think of this? I am not in loco parentis, over my authors. These are grown men and women who have interesting and exciting things to say. I am, what we do is publish their books, and if they have a public presence elsewhere, doing whatever the heck it is that they want to, that's fine. They're grown-ups. We sort of take that attitude about our readers as well, is that, if you're going to be interested in the kind of books that we publish, you're going to be grown up enough to make your own decisions. So we don't interfere with that kind of thing.
I don't know. Assuming that your audience is smart enough to make their own choices, Toni. I mean, that's just bold. That's a bold move, Cotton. Let's see how that plays out.
We don't publish for everybody, right?
Right.
We publish for the kind of people who like the kind of stories we do. It's going to be stuff that's very much in the heart of science fiction and fantasy. And it's going to be a particular feel to that story. I was at dinner with a couple of my newer authors, Patrick Childs and Howard Andrew Jones. One of them writes hard science fiction. One of them writes sword and sorcery, epic fantasy. And we decided that the feeling of Baen is not so much subgenres, but a thread that runs through all of our books is anti-nihilism, right? That there's a certain basic optimism that runs through a Baen book, and that's what our readers look for, I think.
Now that brings to mind a conversation that I had with now my brain just froze up. He runs the Helicon Awards.
Is that Steven Silver?
No. Richard Palinelli.
Oh yeah.
And the superversive movement that has kind of taken hold and started to go, Declan Finn and Sarah Hoyt and that group that are sitting there going, you know, this, the nihilism needs to go away. We need to have hopeful stories. We need to have good guys that win. We have bad guys that are bad guys. And it feels like it's kind of similar to what you're saying here. Have you embraced superversive as a theme, or does it just happen to coincide and that's just the way things are going here?
I don't think we're as prescriptive or proscriptive as the superversive people are. We're not saying that they're, you know, that this is a thing that should be. What we're saying is that this is the kind of thing that we like. You know, if you don't like that, that's fine. I'm not saying you should.
Yeah.
You read what you want to read. You publish what you want to publish, and you give awards to what you want to give awards to. That's fine. We are all free to make our own choices. And that's a good thing.
Yeah. So, well, and you've added new authors. You mentioned some of them, but you've also got Christopher Ruccio and Mona Lisa Foster and Marisa Wolf all coming on board. And you've been publishing stuff from David Weber forever. You've got Timothy Zahn in the roster. You've got Larry Correa there, John Ringo and Wright and Eric Flint. And of course, you know, you've got more stuff coming from Eric, even though, you know, he passed away last year. And
yes,
there's plans for that, and we'll get into that a little bit. How do you decide what determining factors are you looking at as a publisher when you're saying, you know, I want to publish this author? Are they coming to you? Are you you reaching out to them? Is it a mix of both, or how does that work?
It is a mix of both. There's any number of ways to get the attention of our editors. One of them is through our short story contests, and the short story contests are open to everyone. One of them is for near future, near space hard science fiction called the Jim Baen. Oh, there you go. Jim Baen Memorial Award. We just chose a winner for this year. But our fantasy short story award contest, the Baen Fantasy Adventure Award, is still open. So if we have fantasy writers out there who like fantasy adventure, we do too. We're looking. So we look to find new authors there. Both of those contests are judged blindly, which means we don't know who's written the stories. So we are just judging the work itself. And that's, you know, that's how I like to do things. So that's one way to come to our attention. Marisa Wolf and Mona Lisa Foster have both been contributing to Baen original anthologies for some time now, and got our attention that way. Marisa's novel is actually taking place and with characters that were developed for the anthology Chicks in Tank Tops, edited by Jason Cordova. And that was just, you know, it was just an idea that Jason had, and he threw it out there. It's like, surely nobody, you know, surely we can't do this. And I'm like, oh yes, surely we can.
I would think by now that certain themes and topics would just, you know, your authors would just lean into them pretty well, just because let's have some fun with this, because, you know, there are people that are going to complain about it. So let's go for it, you know, and not saying you guys are doing things to deliberately trigger people. But, you know, that there's going to be people out there that are going to look at this and go, that's a little problematic there. But
we're not, you know, deliberately trying to trigger people, but we are trying to have fun, right?
Yeah.
The Chicks in Tank Tops anthology is a really good example of that. I mean, some of the stories are fluffier than others, but some of them are really fairly deep military science fiction. Actually, the novel that Marisa Wolf has expanded her story into is a really deep examination of what happens when AIs take over. You know, what does that mean for the military? What does that mean for the tank on the ground and the lady who runs it? But some of them are just, you know, some of the stories were just wild and crazy. And Esther Friesner, who is the original editor of the Chicks and Chainmail series, her story alone is worth the price of the volume. It's gonzo and wild and crazy, and Jane Austen meets post-apocalyptic military science fiction vampire tank things. You know, I mean, it's just crazy, but oh, it hangs together beautifully and it's great. There's what I'm saying, I guess, is that there's all different ways to have fun in the Baen universe.
Well, and you talk about, you know, chicks and tank tops, and you mentioned, you know, a tank girl, and that makes me think automatically of the comic book Tank Girl, which has me now wondering, I wonder if Baen Books would ever get into publishing comic books and graphic novels. Have you ever thought about getting into that line at all?
Well, it's funny you mentioned that. we are experimenting with that. We've got two co-published graphic novels coming out this spring, one in May and one in June. The one in May is a tie-in to one of our book lines, John Ringo's Black Tide Rising universe, which is a post-apocalyptic zombie universe with an emphasis on rebuilding, right? Not an emphasis on the zombie post-apocalypse, but the post-apocalypse, what it takes to rise above that. We have a new graphic novel team putting that one out, but with a very experienced writer in Chuck Dixon.
That's a name that a lot of people in our audience will recognize right off the bat. Now, who's doing the artwork?
I'm not as clear on the rest of the team, but suffice it to say that they are an experienced graphic novel and comic book team.
That should be fun.
Now,
whose idea was it when you're sitting there going, you know, we should be doing graphic novels and comic books? Was that something that they brought to you from the outside, or was that something internal that somebody came up with and said, here's an untapped market?
It was something that they brought to us, and we want to see how it does in the marketplace, and hope that we can do more of. I've always loved comic books and graphic novels, so it's a natural extension for us. So, you know, fingers crossed that the market will agree with us. And then the other one that we have is a superhero comic book based on a superhero RPG called Ascendant. It too has a very experienced team of artistic team and talent putting together that graphic novel, and that'll be out in June. It's not that one is not tied to any particular Baen book. I'm excited about it.
Are these getting crowdfunded at all, or they're just going to be published and released out in the wild and see what happens?
The first editions of both of them were crowdfunded, and now we are co-publishing a mass market edition and an ebook. So both of them will be available as PDF ebooks as well.
And that was my next question: is how you were going to plan to distribute, because you have the bookstore market, you know, going through Random House and that group to the bookstores, the Barnes and Nobles and the. Used to be Walden Books and B. Dalton, but, you know, they're not around anymore. But you have the book line, and then you have the direct market with the comic book shops and that sort of thing. Are you going to go to comic shops or just sticking to bookstores?
That is the plan. Our distributor is Simon & Schuster, and they do go into comic stores as well as bookstores. So we're hoping to get some of that market penetration. If you don't see them in your favorite comic book shops, you know, tell your managers to special order them, and see if we can't get a little movement there. And if they do well, we will absolutely do more.
That should be fun. I mean, having Chuck Dixon on a book. Just that alone should sell the book. You know, aside from the fact that it's tying into a John Wright, because John Wright's got his audience, and I'm sure there's going to be people that are going to buy the book just simply because it's John. I mean, I did when they did the comic book adaptation of On Basilisk Station, You know, I was trying to, Honor Harrington comic book, sign me up. Let's go. And I'm still waiting for the movie.
It was a new movie company, and they spent all their money doing the movie before Honor Harrington. So we never got to see the Honor Harrington movie, so.
Which is a shame. But one of these days, you know, maybe it'll be a Sci-Fi for Me original film. We'll do the first Honor Harrington movie.
Make me an offer.
Yes. $1 is all I got in my pocket.
That's not going to cut it.
Yeah, no, I know. David wouldn't go for that. But now, that does bring up, because David had posted here not too long ago after Eric Flint passed away, talking about setting up for the future. And the things, what he had, because he's got a lot of stuff still in the pipeline, but he's sitting there saying, I'm getting older and I'm not going to be around forever. And, here, Eric, this happened with Eric, and you've got plans for Eric's stuff. And what happens next? How do you transition, or is there a plan? Is there a set plan for any time you have to make this kind of transition, or is it per author? Just depends on what their designs and plans and instructions are. How do you handle that?
Well, it's a little from column A, a little from column B. David, of course, is incredibly thoughtful and incredibly in tune with his readership. So he's making sure that all of his core series and core properties will have collaborators who understand that series and that universe, and will be able to continue David's path on there, very much like what Tor did with Brandon Sanderson in The Wheel of Time. Picking someone who is a worthy heir to the property. Obviously, David Weber is incredibly successful and has nationally best-selling series plural. So this is more of a concern than for other authors who are maybe not so prolific. Or don't quite have that audience. But I do think planning as part of your estate planning for authors should be designating a literary executor. That is somebody who understands literary properties in particular and will be able to handle that and those rights after you pass so that your heirs can benefit. And also so that your readers can benefit too, so that your properties don't languish. We've seen that over and over again in science fiction. It's just a shame when the heirs don't understand the property don't know what to do with it.
I can't think of anybody that you might be thinking of on that. I don't know.
It could be one of many. Believe me.
Yeah. Oh sure. Well, and I read, it comes to mind the Dragon Riders of Pern, for example, where you have Anne's son and daughter, both. You have Todd and Georgie, I think, are both. No, I can't remember. One of Todd's sisters has written a book as well. And they get it, but it's not. It's not Anne, some people have said the same thing about Brian Herbert and Kevin J. Anderson taking over the Dune books. Sure. There's something about the voice that changes, and naturally, it's a different author is going to be a different thing. But you're right. Having somebody that understands the properties, understands all of the different storylines and where things are going to go. And you've got a note here on the site with regard to Eric's books. You've got stuff that's already in the pipeline, ready to get published. But interesting on this, you say that moving forward, in those story universes, Eric's widow and you, you're all going to be looking at proposals. So these storylines, I guess, are still moving forward, and you're going to take proposals from people and make sure, of course, make sure that they understand the nature of the material. But you guys are going to keep going with some. How many of Eric's universes are going to continue?
Well, I mean, we're looking really at the Ring of Fire, the 1632 CD Shards storylines. But yeah, he's also got a collaboration in the science fiction universe with David Carrico that we'll be putting out there. David's an incredibly good writer. His vampire superhero, The Blood is the Life, came out recently, completely unrelated to 1632, and is great. Just so much fun. But basically, we're going to see, you know, is there a market for these things? Eric never intended an end to the 1632 universe. I mean, it was written as a standalone novel, right? Mm-hmm. You know, over a million words later.
Right.
There were more stories to be told there, right? So there's no necessary storyline that he was building towards. So it's different than, you know, Wheel of Time, right? Yeah. This is a universe that has a potential for a lot of great stories to be written, and they don't have to be written with Eric's voice. They can be written with other authors' voice if there is in fact a market for that. So the next few ones that are coming out are all books that Eric had greater or lesser input in, but he had outlines and story conferences and looked at drafts. So there was a lot of participation from Eric in the ones that will be coming out with his name on. So the question is, you know, going forward, do people still want more of these? And I do, but we'll see what the market bears.
Well, and the other part of that is, you know, you look at expanding universes, shared universes. I mean, David collaborated with Eric. He's collaborated with Tim Zahn and a lot of crossover stuff with the various different story threads in the Honorverse.
Yeah.
Has there been is the shared universe, is the big universe where there's multiple stories in the IP and the franchise, is that our only way to go anymore? Because it feels like there's not that many one and done books. It feels like this is the beginning of a trilogy. This is the first of a series. This is the 10th in the series. Where's my one book that's just one book? Do y'all have any of that?
We do. Simon Green has got a lovely romp through time called For Love of Magic. That'll be out, I don't know, where are you? May. It'll be out in May, actually. So the Eric is probably up. Tim Powers has got My Brother's Keeper coming out in September of this year, which is his approach to the truly weird Bronte family of literary masters.
Right.
Charlotte and Emily and her brother and her father. Now we understand truly how deeply weird they were beyond just the fact that they wrote books. there are people still doing standalone novels. But I think with science fiction and fantasy, once you've gone to the trouble of inventing the universe, even if you intend it as just, all right, this is the story that I want to tell in this universe that I've invented, you're going to find that there's more, if you've done your job right. So some people are just serial universe creators. Jim Hogan was one of those. He didn't really have very many long-running series at all. But that was just how his mind worked and the kind of novels that he wrote. Fred Pohl was I think, in a similar vein. But you know, you have this, you know, you have this great universe. And for the reader too, it's like, I want to go back there. I want to go back to Middle Earth. I want to go back to see what Honor Harrington is doing and to see what her family is up to. And, or the Monster Hunter universe. So it makes sense. It makes sense.
We've got the Honor Harrington movie that didn't happen. Tim Powers had kind of a Pirates of the Caribbean kind of thing there with World's End. Are there any other Baen titles that are being looked at? Any kind of speculation, any kind of offers for movie or TV deals at this point? Do we have that to anticipate?
We know that the Monster Hunter properties are under option, but at this point we don't have a lot of action in Hollywood. We'll see. Maybe next year. We'll see. We'll see if the graphic novels can stimulate some interest.
So. All right. The other thing that I want to ask you has to do with contracts. I want to stick around here for just a second. We're going to take a real quick break so I can tell Google where to interrupt us. And we will be back continuing our conversation with Toni Weisskopf of Baen Books right after this. Stand by.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
I find it difficult to get excited about it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it's my natural cynicism or my pessimism.
Tempered with a dash of pessimism.
I don't know. Maybe I'm jaded at this point.
Perhaps.
The H2O Podcast, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
There is our floating dinosaur. I finally got that thing up. Mrs. Boss saw the floating dinosaur during the first manned SpaceX mission. She's like, I want a floating dinosaur. So there is our floating dinosaur, ladies and gentlemen. All right, we are back live from the bunker, talking with Toni Weisskopf, the publisher at Baen Books. And I want to talk for just a second about legacies, because we're talking about Eric Flint, we're talking about David Weber getting plans in place, we talk about, you know, Todd McCaffrey taking over for his mom, and Brian Herbert, you know. So then we have the Roald Dahl thing, and we have the Agatha Christie thing, and we have the R.L. Stein thing, and R.L. Stein sitting there going, nobody told me they were changing my books. How can something like this even happen? Because, people sit there and go, well, Roald Dahl changed his own books. Yeah, but that's Roald Dahl changing it himself while he's still alive. The rest of this, kind of a little bit of a cringeworthy, problematic moment here. How does something like this happen, and how do you prevent it?
Well, all right. So I will take a potentially controversial view here. We don't need to prevent it, right? We just need to label it. People have been doing versions of literature forever, right? The Lambs did, easy versions of Shakespeare, and that's fine, so long as you say that this is what you're doing, right? This is the safe for children, or this is the safe for you know, my political beliefs version of this. Where I have the problem is where you are pretending that this is the original author's work. Yeah. And that's a lie. And I don't like that at all. And of course, if an author is living, it's just rude.
Right. Well, it, when
say nothing of, I think probably illegal. Yeah.
Well, and when Stein came out and said nobody's talked to me about it, well, I thought, hang on, this just crossed the line into something a lot more. I hate the word problematic, but challenging in respect to, well, now why are they doing it? And why didn't they involve him? And, you know, yet Ian Fleming can't say no. Agatha Christie can't say no. Roald Dahl can't say no. But R.L. Stein can. And, yeah. You know, now Tolkien's estate, I mean, the people, you know, now that Christopher is gone, nobody cares about what's happening with Tolkien-ish. And so you have those things, and people start to speculate who's the next target. And that's what this feels like, is that some of these people, some of these authors, their work is being targeted for sanitation. And you know, comparisons to 1984 are inevitable in this stuff. We're going to rewrite history. We're going to change things to, well, it's always been this way. And now I have to wonder if authors are starting to have those conversations about, okay, we need a clause in our contract that says this doesn't change. The text of my work doesn't change. Have there been discussions at Baen about putting some kind of a clause there in the publishing contracts?
No. I mean, I think our authors understand that we would not do that. So no, that hasn't yet come up. Although, you know, it may in the future, now that this seems to be more prevalent. But yeah, I think it's very hard, especially when somebody has passed, to be able to control your legacy. You know, you're dead. You can't. Yeah. Which is why it's so important again to you know, to nominate that literary executor and backups. Who will respect your work and do with it what you know what you will want, but you know you never know what future technology is going to impinge, there's a limit to what you can control beyond the grave until we invent a science fiction fantasy or potentially horror. necro-literary controller.
Right.
So again, I think the thing for me is, here is a text. Keep the text as it is. You want to change it. If you think what you're doing is so commercial, is so in demand, is such an improvement, call it that, right?
Right.
Label it that. Do not try to pass it off as something that it's not. That is what deeply offends me.
Well, and you being a legacy publisher yourself, I mean, you took over for Jim Baen, and at some point somebody will take over for you, and Baen Books has a particular reputation. You have a particular style and things what you publish. How do you keep that from getting corrupted, changed, inverted? I mean, whatever word you want to put in there, the legacy of certain publishers, certain imprints have certain reputations, and for good or ill, whether it's Tor or Del Rey or Simon & Schuster or whoever, how do you keep the integrity of what you're doing in place? Are there mechanisms in place that you guys are working on to try to make sure that Baen continues to be Baen? Because they've come after you before, and you've survived so far.
Fighting the good fight. we have, and again, I think it's because the market is there, right?
Right.
People want to read the things that we are publishing, so that we have a reason for existing. what's it, a reference to Isaac Asimov mystery series, where there was a club in New York loosely based on an actual literary club, where very smart people would get together and solve crimes, and they would have guests over to dinner, and the first question that they would ask each guest is, how do you justify your existence, right? So, you know, as a publisher, we justify our existence by publishing books that other people want to read. And, as a science fiction fan, you know, as someone who is interested in the future and believes that there will be a future, you know, I have to say that, you know, things are going to change, right? You know, when I shuffle off to that great editor's home in the sky, things will be different. And that's okay, right? So long as people are still wanting the kinds of things that my successor wants to publish. You know, I think in our nearly 40-year history, we've laid down a path, and I will hope that my successor does follow that path. But again, there's only so much you can do from the grave, right?
So you have all of these new authors coming out. You've got these new projects, the stuff that's in the pipeline for Eric, and you've got the new graphic novels. What else is on the calendar for Baen? What's coming up here in the next few months?
Well, we've had sort of two complementary sine waves of genres sort of rising for us. We're just sort of seeing the crest of a hard science fiction moment, where we are publishing books by Patrick Childs, Near Future, Near Space, Rob Hampson, his What would the $6 million man look like if we invent, you know, if we had to do him now? Well, I mean, a lot more than $6 million for one.
Right. But
Hampson is himself a working neuroscientist, so very much a hard science answer to this question. He's working in this field. He helped create the field of bionics.
The moon in the desert. Is that the one? Is that it?
Yes. Yeah. And true science fiction aficionados are going to know that that's a reference to the first episode of the $6 Million Man. That's what it was. That was what it was called. I'm like, I didn't know that. I saw it when I was a kid. I don't remember that.
Right.
But we're also seeing a rise in epic fantasy.
We've got
some really great epic fantasy coming up. Tim Akers. Wraithbound is coming out this spring. Larry Correa's Tower of Silence. Yeah, Tower of Silence it is also coming out this spring in his Saga of the Forgotten Warrior. We have Gregory Frost is doing his take on Thomas the Rhymer, which is very dark and really good. That'll be coming out later this year. And Howard Andrew Jones has got the first couple of a five novel sequence in his Sword and Sorcery. Very much heir of Robert E. Howard, heir of Conan kind of feel to it. Great stuff.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because anytime I hear Baen Books, I don't think of fantasy that much. Has there been a conscious choice to kind of start leaning into that and expand? Because you guys are military science fiction. You know, that's what I always think of when I think Baen. It's the hard science fiction. It's the military science fiction. And now here you are with all of these fantasy stories coming out. Is that a conscious choice, or just kind of worked out that way that, hey, this is a good story, we're going to publish it?
The latter. We've always been fans. Jim Baen and I have always been fans of epic fantasy and sword and sorcery. And there's just a dry spell in submissions for a long time of things that just weren't quite you know, up to the level that we like to publish. We did Deed of Paxnarian by Elizabeth Moon back in the 80s. That was great, and I guess maybe we got a little spoiled. we were looking for stuff as good as that, and I think we're starting to get it again now. So I think there's a new generation who are sort of aware that there is this, you know, where is the great fantasy, in the mode of Robert E. Howard or in the mode of Dita Paxenarian? And I think we're seeing it again now. And, you know, I'm just very, very happy to read it and be able to publish it.
Now, you mentioned Conan the Barbarian. Chuck Dixon has got a book out, an adaptation there in that universe. And it makes me wonder, have you all talked about going for tie-in licenses? Because I don't think you guys publish any tie-in fiction, do you?
Again, it's something that we've tried in the past. We did a series of game tie-ins back in the early 90s to mid-90s. And they did very nicely. Mercedes Lackey did some. Bill Fortune did some for us. Various different games. And they did okay, but they didn't tear up the universe. So we kind of stepped away from that. It's not something I rule out, but we've been enjoying, being the originator of universes.
Right. Well, cause it makes me, I have to go back to the Dungeons and Dragons mess from earlier this year with Wizards of the Coast doing their whole thing with the OGL and people blowing up about it. And now you have all of these other groups that are saying, well, we're going to come up with our own gaming license. We're going to do our own thing. Paizo being one of them with the Pathfinder stuff. And, you know, you have the Dungeons and Dragons movie that's coming out, which I recommend for people to watch. It's a fun movie. I'm entertained. That's the key thing here. You know, it didn't lecture me. It didn't preach at me. It was fun. And right? So now there are other game companies that are coming to the fore that people are starting to talk about that maybe we haven't talked about before because WotC had the corner on the market. But now there are these other opportunities. So maybe there's something there where, you know, you talk about game tie-ins. Y'all have done that before. Maybe there's an opportunity here. I see the wheels turning there, Toni. Have you got something brewing?
I do. We don't have anything on paper yet, but hopefully the next time I come on, I'll be able to talk to you about that. Yeah.
Okay. All right. See, it's there we go. So what else is going on with Baen? I mean, where's the next? I mean, you got all these epic fantasies coming out and this science fiction stuff. And the graphic novels, Baen games. Are we going to get into publishing games? Are you going to start putting RPGs?
I can't talk about it now, but hopefully there will be more news. Yeah.
Well, it does seem like a lot of companies these days, especially given the last two or three years, there has to be some diversification that you might not otherwise have thought about. It's like, well, we got slammed because of X. Maybe we need to pivot. We need to do something else. Has this something that's been brewing for a long time, or is this the result of where we've been the last couple of years?
It's something that's sort of been in the offing for a while, and I think we have a good plan for making it work. So as I say, I can't really talk about it right now, but we have drawn a lot of our writers from gaming. David Weber and Steve White, their first novels for us were set in the Starfire war game universe. Chuck Gannon got his start also writing for gaming. Larry Correa is a huge gamer himself. David Weber also games. There's a lot of crossover between the game universe and the people who create for the games, the people who consume Baen books, the people who write Baen books. So it really is a natural progression for us.
Yeah. Any chance of some sort of a partnership with the Gygax family? I mean, that would invite all sorts of trouble, but, you know, there's that thing. I mean, you talk about a legacy. I mean, I mean, that's the beginning, right? That's the OG, you know, the TSR D&D stuff. Yeah. And I know you guys can't do D&D in terms of, you know, a license or a tie-in or anything like that, but I would certainly be interested in some sort of a competitive product coming from Baen, whether it's an RPG or just tie-in license stories that are coming out of that universe. I think that would be a great move for you guys.
Good to know.
I'm looking forward to it when it gets announced, if it ever gets announced. We'll say that.
Fingers crossed, yeah.
So how soon should we expect any kind of announcement, assuming that you guys follow the timeline that you expect to be on?
Oh, it should be sometime this year, yeah.
Okay, all right. So we'll definitely have to make it less than 2 years for your next time on the show. by the way, that link to Tony's first appearance is in our notes. Anybody wants to see that one? Was it February? What did I have here? February of 2021. I didn't realize it had been that long. So, but yeah, we'll definitely have to have you back when stuff gets announced, whatnot. Now, the things that you have kind of sort of not really revealed, is this a first? Are we dropping exclusives here at all?
Well, you're the first person who has guessed. So.
Okay, I feel smart now, so that's always good. Okay, so where people can find all of the stuff going on with Baen, let's see here. You've got Baen Books, Baen.com is the main one. What are the titles that are coming out? This here, the new releases, these are the ones that are about to drop, or they're out now?
The new releases are out now, and then the next row under there are the advanced reader copies, electronic, the ebook versions of the advanced reader copies. So those are the ones that are just about to be printed in paper.
Okay. So these advanced reader copies, let me ask you this real quick, because it seems almost counterintuitive. You're putting the books out there before you sell the books.
Yes. Well, the longer version is that we had a very active fan feedback system in Baen's bar. And the barflies were very upset that we were sending these bound galleys, as we called them back then, to book reviewers who were then selling them in bookstores, especially in New York. And they were commanding ridiculous prices because our fans wanted the early versions of the books. And this was in the late 90s, just as we were starting up our ebook program. And they said, look, you know, we'll pay you for this unedited, pre-proofread, raw version of the book. Just, forget about giving it away. You know, we will pay you for this. And Jim was like, oh, no, not really. And then somebody broke into our servers looking for the latest on our Harrington. And Jim was like, all right, fine. I will sell it to you.
So it's all David's fault.
Yeah. So we listened to our audience and they said, yes, we will do this. And we found a price point that made sense. So you are paying more for the unedited, raw, not final, guaranteed to not be final version of the book. But for those people who are true fanatics who have to have it first, it's a great thing. I've got my authors for whom I absolutely, yes, give it to me now, give it to me now, give it to me now. I don't care if you're typos, give it to me now. But also there are people who will buy it and the final ebook and do a compare and see, all right, well, where did the changes come in? And sometimes there are significant changes between versions.
So these advanced reader copies are not the final form. This is pre-evolved to its final Pokemon state, right?
Yes. Guaranteed to be different from the final book. Yes.
It's interesting that so many people have an interest in that. Now, because we'll get advanced reader copies sometimes from different publishers for reviews.
Sure.
But you know, it's not a frequent thing, and the fact that people are willing to pay for that kind of thing and get into that. Have you found talent that way? How do I ask this? Because you know, you get beta readers, you get advanced readers. You know, on the editing side of things, have you ever found any editors that went, hey, I found this and this and this, and what if you did this? And, you know, does anybody ever give you feedback on these readers?
We are not looking for that kind of feedback at that stage. So, no, that is not if you are an incipient editor, that is not a good way to come to our attention.
Yeah.
But you know, please do send a resume. So.
are there openings at Baen right now?
Not right now. No, we generally don't. We're a small, lean entrepreneurial company, and there's not generally a lot of openings. So,
and how are you finding your next batch of authors? Are you open for submissions right now or no?
Yes, yeah, we are. We're always open. Right now, we as you pointed out, we just signed a bunch of new to Baen authors, including Christopher Rocchio and Mona Lisa Foster and Marisa Wolf and Howard Andrew Jones and we have several other authors that we're developing who are, you know, newer in the last few years, Kevin Eikenberry and Patrick Childs. And there are others out there too. So there's not a lot of openings in the list either. That said, we never close our submissions. We are always looking for those, you know, for the next Heinlein, the next McCaffrey, the next Sturgeon, the next, the next Bujold, the next Moon, even though Bujold and Moon are still ready and doing great stuff.
Yeah. Okay, well, I may have something to send you. All right, so the website, baen.com. Baen is also on Facebook, and I understand it's a fairly active group over there. You've also got Baen over on MeWe. Tony's on MeWe, and I think you've got a YouTube channel?
There's a YouTube channel and there's a Rumble channel, and anything that goes on YouTube is also gets to Rumble too.
Okay, all right. We'll put those links in the notes as well, and make sure everybody's got that information. And we will definitely have to do this again. Toni Weisskopf from Baen Books, number two under your belt. We'll have to go for a three-peat very, very, very soon.
I like it. Yeah, all right. Sounds great.
Well, I appreciate you being here. And thanks to everybody, all of you, for being here as well. Tomorrow on the program, Baen authors, Mike Rothman and Dave Butler will be here. And we'll be talking about their new work as well as some of their process for creating their worlds. So that's going to be on. Find us on all the different social media accounts that we've got listed here. There's 10 of them. 11 too many. The newsletter, the Discord, subscribe star if you want to send us money. Oh, by the way, Rumble just announced that through the end of 2023, they've got this new thing rolling out, a subscriber pack where $5 a month, and the creators get to keep all of it through the end of 2023. So they're not taking a cut. So if you want to support us or any of the other Rumble channels that you follow, there's that option now as well. Of course, we've got the different memberships on Rumble or on Odyssey and YouTube. So lots of different ways that you can support this channel and any of the other channels that you follow. And I do recommend you do that. That's it for us, folks. Thanks very much for being here. Remember, the politicians hate you. The media lies to you. God has a plan for you. And there are four lights.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2023 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.